Thank you, Anton.
Thank you.
So thank you for the nice introduction and for the invitation to talk here. It's quite an impressive room. So actually, it's very nice to talk after law, since I will also talk about large systems and what happens when the size of the system goes to infinity. But somehow the emphasis will be rather on a strongly coupled system, such as the eigenvalues of random matrices. And the emphasis that I would like to put in this talk is about some kind of common way to analyze these systems, which is actually quite old, as I will try to show, and which is based on the uses of Schwinger-Dyson equations. Okay, so there was quite a lot of freedom in the interpretation of the world panorama in the conference, so I decided to start the panorama at the beginning of probability theory. And in France, I don't know in Germany, but people say that somehow the first real paper in probability theory goes back to Pascal and Fermat, letters between these two guys, and where they were discussing how to share the loot of in a coin game. So namely, you have a game of two players, and they have, they say that the one who will win will be the one who will get, like, let's say, three head. And then they have to stop before this is achieved. So for instance, one got two heads and one got one head. So how should they share the money that they bet? So this was apparently at least the beginning of probability theory, very interesting and deep questions. And of course, this got more complicated, and questions around this team were asked. And for instance, what happens if the two players play during the whole night? And so as Laure mentioned, you have the law of large number. So if you play with a coin, so it follows the so-called Bernoulli law. So this means that you will have a random variable which will take only two values, success or failure with probability P. So if you have a fair coin, it's like P equal 1/2. And so what Bernoulli proved, so soon after this correspondence between Pascal and Fermat, was that you will see about Pn success, so P is the probability of success, and if you have n trials, but provided you accept to have an error which is of order of the number of trials. Okay, so the probability to get between Pn minus An and Pn plus Bn success, when you throw your coin n times, will go to one. But there was even a more interesting result, which was given soon after by De Moivre, which is that in fact the error is not of size the number of trials, but of order the square root of the number of trials. So namely, what De Moivre proved was that if you look at a window of order square root of n, so if you look at the probability to observe between Pn minus A square root of n and Pn plus B square root of n success, then this will go to some number between 0 and 1, which will be the probability of the interval minus AB under the normal or Gaussian law. So actually, during Laure talks, we already saw this, this law appearing. And so what I want to discuss in this talk is more appearance of this Gaussian law in more and more complicated settings. So, in fact, again, soon after, there was the question of understanding more complicating trials. So, for instance, Laplace considered census population census, and he was wondering, so he was looking there at the number of boys per girl in France, and the question was whether there was some kind of mean average, like the law of large number, and also some fluctuation which will be given by the normal law. So here you can see that the random variable would be the number of boys per girl, and so this takes some kind of continuous values. And there were also much more esoteric kind of studies, like by Ketele, who was trying to see if the Laplace law is appearing when you look at physical characteristics. So Ketele was very dedicated statistician who measured nearly 6,000 chests of Scottish soldiers. So, so fortunately you have theory, and you may avoid this kind of arts application. And so this was done by Laplace, who indeed showed that in great generality the central limit theorem holds. So if you take independent variables, then when they are renormalized by the number of variables, it will converge to the mean, and the error towards this convergence is given by the normal distribution. Okay, so now I come to what I want to discuss in this talk. So this kind of picture is supposed to summarize that. So we were asked to talk about new challenges. So one of the new challenges in probability theory is to understand strongly coupled systems. So what I have told you about is independent systems, which are kind of trivial, and this is represented by this row where it's written random. So I don't know. I'm going to try to do something. Ah, yes. So this row. So this row represents independent trial. So imagine you throw these coins and you put a black line each time to have success, and you put zero. You put no line otherwise. And so you get this kind of random point process, which is kind of very randomly distributed. And so what we would be interested in is to study more ordered kind of systems, which are the eigenvalues of random matrices. It's becoming more and more dangerous, actually, and less effective. Here. Yes. So these were the eigenvalues of random matrices. So you can see that when you draw them, they are not kind of periodically distributed, they are still random, but much less random than these random trials. And we would like to understand the fluctuation of this kind of guys. And this, so in connection, so here you have other lines, so this in connection to the energy level of excited nuclei. Or also, so there is this line which is just done to wake up a few. Which is the connection with zeta zeros, the zeros of zeta function, which I will not talk about at all. Okay, so we will concentrate on the eigenvalues and the fluctuation of these eigenvalues. Okay, so as I said, so this kind of system are much more ordered, and one way to see that is, for instance, so if you look at this drawing, this drawing here. So this represents a dynamics on the eigenvalues of Gaussian matrices. And so that at each time, so if you start from the low of these matrices, you will get at each time the same low. So it's an invariant, a stationary process. And you can see that for a stationary process for the eigenvalues, you need to have lines, so paths, the paths of each eigenvalues are going to avoid each other. Okay, so they stay ordered. Whereas if you would have put some process, some invariant measure in on random thing, you would get Boolean motion, and typically they would intersect each other. So this is just to highlight that the structure of random of eigenvalues are strongly repulsive. So you have a strong repulsion, and you have to take this into account. And in the lower line, yeah. So you can see a related problem. So it doesn't seem to be related like this, but it's this random tiling. So you take a tiling at random uniformly by just imposing some boundary conditions. And you look at the position of, let's say, the horizontal tiles. And what you can see is that this, and you would like to understand also the macroscopic behavior of this kind of tiles. And also in this case, you have this kind of repulsion of the level sets, which somehow show that this is a quite ordered and structured random variables. Okay, and we would like to understand fluctuations and convergence in this kind of settings. So what I will mostly discuss is global fluctuations. So namely, here there is a representation of eigenvalues of a large, let's say 10,000 per 10,000 random matrix. So the eigenvalue will be, let's say, between -100 and 100. And you would like to understand what are the, is the number of eigenvalues which are falling in a set with size. So here I put 0.50, but something macroscopic. And what are the, so what is the limit and what are the fluctuations? So in general, the fluctuations will be Gaussian. And I will discuss how to use this Schringer-Dyson equation to understand that. And there are also questions about local fluctuations. So there were lots of work on local fluctuations of this kind of systems. So for instance, if you consider the largest eigenvalue of this random matrix, where should it be? Should it be very far from the other eigenvalue? Or how should it fluctuate? So this was understood to converge once properly scaled at some distance, some small distance of the of the boundary of the support of the bulk, and the fluctuation was shown to be tracy with them. Also, you can wonder, you know, what is the number of eigenvalues which will fall in a very tiny interval. So before I was saying, let's take an interval of size 0.50, but now if I take an interval of size 0.1, I would expect to have only finitely, I mean, 10 or 100 eigenvalues falling in this interval. This is a much more local information. Okay, so I will shortly discuss this local fluctuation at the end of the talk, but the, in general, the local fluctuations are not given in terms of the Gaussian law, but more complicated law. And so I will come back to that at the end of the talk. Okay, so now let me go into more math symbols. So what is the object? So the central object in is this random matrices. So this is called the GUE. So you consider a matrix Xn, which is n times n, and it's Hermitian, and you fill it above the diagonal with independent complex Gaussian variables, which are centered on with a covariance 1 over n. And there is a strange noise, no? Okay. on the diagonal, you take real independent variables, which are also Gaussians. Okay, so you can summarize the distribution of this matrix Xn as this Gaussian law. So you have here the Lebesgue measure on Hermitian matrices, and you have a Gaussian weight. So you can see that this is exactly the weight to give you Gaussian entries. And you just renormalize it by the n so that you get the probability measures. Okay, so this is a central object. And one of the nice features of this this particular matrices is that you can see that they are invariant. So if you multiply them by on the left and the right by a unitary matrix, so you conjugate uxn u star, then the law is unchanged. And therefore, it's you can get the distribution of the eigenvalues, and just by doing a change of variable, and you see that the distribution of the eigenvalues is going to be independent of the distribution of the eigenvectors. Okay, and in particular, you have this nice formula which you can get only for these very specific ensembles. So here I realize that I wrote the law of the unordered eigenvalues, but if I would like to keep in the spirit of before, and in order to, here I got the exchangeable somehow law, the unordered laws of the eigenvalues, but I could, if I would consider the ordered eigenvalue, I would just add the characteristic function of this set. Okay, so now the question, so what you see in this distribution of the eigenvalues is that it's strongly correlated. So namely, if you look at the Lebesgue measure in this law, it will play a very little role, a priori, in the sense that if you look at some event which will not be very favorable for the Lebesgue measure, This will have typically some probability of order exponential minus n times the entropy. So the entropy is sign of entropy like Laure introduced. Whereas if you look at some event which is not favorable for the rest of the term, so this interaction, so it will be much smaller, it will be of order exponential minus n squared, okay, because you are multiplying n squared terms, roughly speaking. So what you see is that these laws are strongly driven by their interaction, rather than by the randomness, so you have to find new ways to analyze this kind of systems. So what are the kind of results that have been obtained for this type of laws? So let me consider some kind of generalization of this law. So this is the same law as the one of the GUE matrices, except here I put some beta, so beta was equal to 2 in the previous case. And I add some potential V, which replaces the quadratic potential. All right, so when beta equal 1 or 4, this and V is quadratic, this is still the law of a matrix with independent entries. So when beta equal to 1, you just take Gaussian entries, which are real. And when beta equal to 4, you take symplectic entries. And in fact, it was shown by Dumitriou and Edelman that for any of these positive beta, you can define a random matrix, but which this time have only non-zero entries on the diagonal on the line above the diagonal on the one under the diagonal, so it's a symmetric matrix, whose entries are independent despite the symmetry constraint, and which eigenvalue of this distribution. Okay, so for all of this model, when V is quadratic, you can associate a random matrix, but there is only the case beta equal 1, 2, or 4, which correspond to this kind of invariant ensembles. Okay, so the type of result which we obtained for these laws are as follows. So first, so we assume that V is some kind of nice potential. And so first you have the law of large number, so meaning that if you take a function f, a test function f, and you renormalize it, this will converge almost surely towards some limit, which depends on the probability measure mu v, which is called the equilibrium measure. Okay. And then you can study the fluctuation of this quantity, so of the empirical measure. And so if I assume that v is analytic, then, and this is only technical, I mean this could be removed, if I assume also that the support of the equilibrium measure is connected, then the fluctuation of this empirical measure will be Gaussian, okay, as for independent variables. Okay, so this is one of the main results. So the other result is that if mu v is not connected, then the fluctuation will not be Gaussian. In fact, it will depend, there will be kind of convolution of discrete and continuous Gaussian law. And you have only convergence along subsequences. And this can be seen, for instance, so if you have a potential V like this, so you will have a big tendency to have lots of eigenvalues in this set, and in this set, so your mu V will be disconnected. And what will happen is that the number of eigenvalues in each of the connected components will vary. You will have a tunneling effect. So because you have to be careful that, on the contrary here to the classical central limit theorem, the central limit theorem here does not have any renormalization, so the fluctuations are very tiny. And in particular, so in this second case, when you take f to be 1, let's say, on this set, okay, and 0 otherwise, on smooth, so 0 and 1, so then Mn of f will just be the cardinal, the number of eigenvalues in one of these sets. So let's say S2. And so what you see that the random variable you are considering is just an integer of numbers minus some numbers which does not need to be an integer. So there is no way it will converge towards a Gaussian variable. And in general, you have to take subsequences to get convergence of this kind of guys. Okay, so in my title, I had put unrelated models, where they said there is some analog, which is this discrete analog, which is given by the tilings, random tilings. So you look at some law, which is this time on Z, and you consider the same kind of Kurungas interaction. But so indeed, this time you don't take integral under the Lebesgue measure. So the interest in this kind of distribution comes from this random tiling. So if you look at a vertical line in your tiling, so let's say here, so you will have a given number of horizontal lozenges that you can call n, and then you can ask what is the distribution of the position of these lozenges. Okay, and this will be the Li. Okay, and the point is that you can define through the weight W here well enough so that this will give you the distribution of these horizontal lozenges when you take a uniform tiling. Okay, so what I want to state is a result similar to the previous one. So I had this generalization of a beta ensemble. So there is also a generalization of beta ensemble in this case. So this time it's a bit more complicated. You have to put gamma functions. So if theta equal to 1, this is exactly the same law as before. Now if theta is just positive number, you have to use definition of gamma functions. And for this kind of laws, you have the same kind of result as the one before. So namely, if your weights are behaving well enough at infinity, so it's kind of behaving like what you would expect for a matrix model, then you will get a convergence of the empirical measure of the Li once renormalized. And you can get also a convergence. So you can get the central limit theorem, so the fluctuation will again be Gaussian. So again, you'd have no normalization, so you look at the empirical measure, unnormalized, you subtract the limit, and you will have convergence towards a Gaussian variable. Okay, so this is... the last model I want to discuss is matrix models. And so this is another generalization of one matrix. And so these models are dear to my heart because I came to this subject interested by this type of question. So as Anton said, and I can see he's doing a bad face, so free probability is a bit... is a theory of probability for non-commutative variables. And one of the central questions in this field would be as follows. So imagine you take sequences of matrices, which are n times n, and you assume that whatever of the world or in these matrices that you are taking, so this converges. Almost surely. So the matrices could be random or they could be non-random. I mean, this is not important. So it converges. It converges towards what? Towards some linear functional on the set of monomials, which satisfy some properties because it has to satisfy the same properties as the... So let's say that the Xi are self-adjoint. Okay, so it will satisfy some properties that if you take any polynomial, you multiply it by its conjugate, then this has to be non-negative. The trace of 1 is equal to 1. And also you have the threshold property that for any polynomial, the trace of PQ is equal to the trace of QP. Okay, and so one of the central questions in the field is to know whether you can somehow approximate any of these slow toes, which are these linear forms on the set of polynomials, by matrices. Okay, so this is a famous conjecture which goes back to Cohn's PhD thesis. And somehow, considering the models I'm presenting you now is kind of an attempt to get a better understanding of this question, because if you come from statistical mechanics, you would like to think that if you take any Gibbs measure and you take sufficiently complicated potential V, you can somehow get you can somehow describe the world. No? Okay, so the question would be, let's consider this precise random matrices. Can we get this kind of convergence, and what would be the properties of the limit? Okay, so in fact, for this kind of question, unfortunately, we are only able to answer for very few potential V. So here I wrote that we can do it for perturbation of the quadratic potential. We can also do it for strictly convex potential, but this is still work in progress for 3 or 4 years, actually. And still, so what we get is the same kind of result as the result I stated before. So namely, we get convergence, and we get Gaussian fluctuations. So let me go. Okay, so now what I would like to, so what I try to show you are 3 models which have in common to be to deal with variables which are far from being independent, which are strongly coupled. And what I would like to show you now is that there is kind of a unified way to approach them, to try to analyze them. Okay? And so, to that end, let me go back to the first proof of the central limit theorem, which is due to Laplace. And so, one of the big ideas of Laplace, well, only a very one, a little one, was to introduce this Laplace transform. Okay, so the Laplace transform is just this exponential of t times x under dp. And with the idea that for independent variable, you can compute it easily. Okay, because, so if you take now the law of independent variable and you compute its Laplace transform, by independence, it will just factorize. Okay, so the idea is that then that to prove the central limit theorem, if you can just evaluate the Laplace transform of the original law for very small parameters, which you can do just by Taylor expansion, then you will prove the central limit theorem. So this kind of idea is very difficult to generalize to this strongly coupled system. And what we will rather try to discuss is the approach by Stein of the central limit theorem. So what is the proof of central limit theorem by Stein? It goes as follows. So the idea is that you look again at this law of this in the sum of independent variables. And what you want to say that it's going to be tight, so this means you can take limit points, and all the limit points will satisfy some equation which has a unique solution. So in the case of the Gaussian law, so this equation is that for all smooth function f, the integral of f of x times x under your measure will be just given by integral of f prime of x dqx. So it's kind of integration by part. You can check that this has a unique solution just by taking, for instance, moment. So if f of x is just x to the n, you see that these equations give you moments by induction, uniquely. And this is the Gaussian law. Okay, and to just convince you that this equation has to be true at the limit, so you just write the formula for the integral of x f of x dpn. You can use exchangeability to expand the term in x, so this is the first line. Then by centering of the x1 on independence, you can subtract the function where you have removed the first variable. And then you can use again Taylor expansion and use again independence to see that your law dpn must approximately satisfy this Stein equation. Okay, so for this proof that the Stein equation is valid is pretty relies quite a lot on independence, But however, what I want to claim is that you can use this kind of IDs in a much broader setup. Okay, and so what will be the ID to attack this kind of beta ensemble? So first we will prove the law of large number, so either by using the Stein methods or large deviations or saddle point analysis. And then in the ID of Laplace, we will try to compute to estimate Laplace transforms. Okay? But the way we are going to estimate them is of course more complicated than what Laplace could do. And so the idea now is to use this equation, so this system of equations, the Schwinger-Dyson equations, and to try to solve them recursively in terms of the dimension. Okay? So I will show you how to do that on the beta ensemble just after that. So we will get this Schwinger-Dyson equation, then the point will be to analyze which are the small terms which do not play any role in the limits. And then, as Laure was saying, you linearize your system around the limit and you solve the linear equation. Okay, so that's, some people say it's Stein method, some others just say it's perturbation methods, but it's a very kind of common feature to try to analyze a large N dependency of random of variables. Okay, so let me be a bit more specific. So to get the limit, so as I said, if you have this beta ensemble, the best is to do some kind of large deviation principle. So what you can prove is that the empirical measure of your eigenvalues will satisfy a large deviation principle with an entropy, which is here given by the potential. So on the contrary to what happens with law, the entropy, the sign of entropy does not play any role. You are left with the entropy given only by the interaction. And you can prove this kind of estimate or convergence of the empirical measure just by looking to actually this interaction and seeing that it's approximately given, and of course all the work is in the approximately, by exponential minus n squared times the entropy of your empirical measure. Okay, once you know that the density is of this form, again, the entropy related to the randomness of the lambda I will be neglectable, and you see that you have to converge toward the minimizer of the entropy. Okay, so now let me go to these fluctuations and what will be the Schwinger-Dyson equation. So in this setting, the Schwinger-Dyson equation are very closely related to the Stein methods. So Stein method was somehow to prove that you have a limiting integration by parts formula. So here you get equation just by integration by parts. Okay, I will not derive this equation for you here. I mean, it's really an easy thing to see that somehow the left-hand side is coming from some derivative of the density. Okay, and the right-hand side is coming from the integration by parts. Okay, so you see that here, if I would apply directly Stein method, the idea would be just to look at Ln and say I want to prove that Ln is converging. So I see that this term here will be neglectable because I have a 1 over n. And I see that here, if Ln is converging, I could replace Ln by any limit points. And in fact, so then what I get is some equation which will be satisfied by all critical points of the energy. So in general, when you just put this to be zero, you don't have a unique solution, except when V is convex, is strictly convex. But you always get an equation which is satisfied by the minimizer of the entropy. Okay, so what we are going to do now is to use the fact that we know that we have convergence and simply to linearize the equation around the limit. Okay? And so, in this setting, what is nice to do is to consider a subset of a test function when V is analytic, so which are the Stieltjes transform, because then you get a nice closed formula for the Stieltjes transform. Okay? And so here K is just some operator that you get when you linearize your equation. Okay, and W and Z here is just It's just the difference with the of the stageless, the empirical measure taken as the stageless transform minus the limit. Okay, and so you see what you want to do. Somehow in this equation, you want to find out what are the small terms. So it turns out that if you expect WNZ to be of order 1 over n, this should be neglectable, and this should be the main term. So this is exactly what happened. So by concentration of measure, what you can prove is that n times the square term is going to 0, and therefore if you can invert your linear operator, okay, then what you get is a first order correction for your differences of stageless transform. Okay, so it's always the same kind of trick. Once you have a limit, you linearize around your limit, and the fun is that you can continue like this. Actually, we can get all the correction of order 1 over n to the p by doing this kind of thing recursively. Okay, and so the point is that once you have done that, you can conclude that you get your Gaussian law, simply because, as I said, you have this log of the Laplace transform, which is going to be given by some integral of this guy, where you have changed a bit f, so this is just an integration by the potential v. So you can apply the strategy I just told you on this law, and you get exactly a term which is quadratic in the function, or in the Landau, a term which is linear. Okay? So what I wanted to advertise is that this kind of approach works in much more general settings. So with Gaëtan Borot and with Ron, maybe, and with Inbon at least, and Karol Kozlowski, we generalize this kind of thing with more general interaction. This kind of approach also generalizes to these several matrix models that I introduced before. So you have also a Schwinger-Dyson equation. And the point is that in this setting, you don't have a large deviation. We don't know how to prove large deviation. But in the case where we can show that we have a unique solution to this limiting Schwinger-Dyson equation, so we are in a good shape to apply exactly Stein method and to prove convergence. So actually, in the several matrix models, we can generalize this to R distributed matrices or to many other questions, but we are unable to prove uniqueness of solution of this type of equation unless we are in kind of perturbative or strictly convex situations. So that's really the limit of the theory so far. And for discrete beta models, actually, it was a question I was wondering for a long time, whether we could apply this kind of technology in the discrete case. It's not easy to see because actually when you do integration by parts in the discrete setting, people who have done that know that usually it's far to be as nice. And in fact, when you do this kind of trick to do integration by parts, what you get is equations which are not only depending on the empirical measure. So it's pretty hard to analyze. So fortunately, I met Andrei Okunkov in Tel Aviv 1 year or so ago, and he told me about this very nice equation that Nekrasov derived, which he calls non-perturbative Schwinger-Dyson equations. And this equation, which are kind of, I would say it's kind of massive use of integration by parts, somehow, can be analyzed in the same spirit than what I just showed you. Okay, so I still have, Okay, so actually I went pretty fast, so maybe I will make over the Anton will be very happy. Okay, so I was thinking I cannot do a talk about random matrices without telling you a bit about local fluctuations. So the thing which is quite different about local fluctuations is that in fact the derivation of the limits are still very much model dependent. So I will only consider the beta ensembles and only the fluctuation at the edge. There are similar questions about fluctuations in the bulk, but I mean just to, since I have a limited time, I will just talk about this edge. And so it was shown in the So in the 90s by Tracy and Whedon, that indeed, so if you look at the largest eigenvalues, it will converge towards 2, which is the limit of the bulk. So for this model, actually I forgot to put a beta in the, so there should be some beta over there. But okay, so it's just to make sure that the bulk has a semicircle law which density vanishes exactly at 2. But so it goes, so the idea that the largest eigenvalue will converge towards the boundary of the bulk, and the error will be of order n to the 2/3, n to the minus 2/3, and the limit laws will depend on beta this time. Okay, so for each beta, if you look at the expectation of g and of this largest eigenvalues, largest eigenvalue, it will converge to the expectation of g under this law f beta, which are represented there. So the way to prove this kind of result is completely different to what I discussed. Mainly in the case beta equal to 2, you have a very nice feature of this model, which is that the interaction can be seen as a determinant to the square, just because the product of the lambda I minus lambda j is just a Van Dermond determinant. And because of this specific form, you can use orthogonal polynomials to analyze this probability measure. So this is how they could derive this kind of limit laws. And in the case 1 and 4, it's more complicated. You have what you call a Pfaffian law. However, they could still manage to analyze this limit laws. So by completely different techniques, Ramirez, Ryder, and Virag could also prove that there was such a limiting behavior for all beta non-negative. And this time the strategy was very different. It was using this representation by Dumitriou and Edelman, so who showed that these laws is the law of the eigenvalues of matrices where you have zeros except on the diagonal on the sub on three lines. Okay, so somehow you have zeros and zeros everywhere, and you have independent entries which are either chi-square or Gaussian viable, and because of this specific structure, they could use arguments closer to maybe the Schrödinger operator kind of argument to prove that you have convergence of the fluctuation of the eigenvalues at the boundary. Okay, so this at present is always derived by very specific tool. What I just want to argue is that still all these kind of apparatus I discussed around Tringer-Dyson equation can be very useful to prove universality. So, namely, now if you go back to this kind of beta laws where you have potentials. A potential V replacing the X square, then what you can prove is that if V is smooth and the support of mu V is connected, actually this is not so important, but you have to assume that you are in off-critical situation, so the support, the density vanishes at the boundary of the support like a square root, then you can show that the local fluctuation of the eigenvalues at the edge or the same as in the case where you have a quadratic potential. Okay, I have to say that so these two, our work is the same year, but somehow Bourgade, Erdős, and Yao published a similar result on universality on the bulk much before, and our paper is really after their paper. So I'm not pretending at all that our paper was at the same time, but what I want to argue is that our arguments are very closely related to the Tringer-Dyson equation and kind of connected also with Cedric Stoke. So let me, and also to the Tringer-Dyson equation. So let me just give you a flavor of how you can prove universality by using this kind of statement. So what we did with Florent and Alessio was to construct approximate transport. So Cedric talked about optimal transport. So optimal transport would be a map. So a map which maps you exactly So a merger on another one. So this annotation. So this is just for this. So it's just a push forward. Okay. So there is a question of constructing such maps. So what we are doing is not really constructing such map, because what we are interested in is the dependency of the maps in the terms of the dimension. Because again, what we want to do is to analyze large systems. And so the idea was to say, well, we don't know in general what is the dependency in the dimension of the optimal transport maps. But what we can try to do is to construct some maps, which will be nice. So we want T to be just a tensorial, plus something which will be small, neglectable. So why will we be happy if we can do that? Because if we know that our eigenvalues of interest, so lambda n is like T0, I don't know, maybe it's 2, maybe I should put it here. Okay, so if we know that lambda n is T0 of lambda tilde n, so lambda tilde n plus 1 over n T1 n, so lambda tilde, where lambda tilde, we know its fluctuation because it's given by the law of the GUE, then we can always write that this is approximately T0 of 2 plus the error, so n minus 2/3, n plus 2/3 lambda n minus 2, well, times this error plus something which will be small. Okay, so the idea is that if you get such approximate transport map, somehow the fluctuation of the maximum eigenvalue you are considering will be given by the fluctuation of the eigenvalues that you are transporting. Okay, simply because you have just a straight transport. Okay, and so the point is that now if you want to find this kind of transport maps, you will write again equations, which it has to satisfy, and you will realize, but I will not do it for you, that it's closely related to the Schwinger-Dyson equation. So now in all these cases, what you are basically trying to do is to understand the infinitesimal generator related to your problem and to compute Green functions, and this is also the case here. Okay, so let me conclude. So as a conclusion, so what I try to show you is that this type of time method or Schwinger-Dyson equation can be used to study the strongly coupled system. So you can get convergence of macroscopic observable, like in the several matrix case. You can get the fluctuations. You can also get eventually this universality by kind of extending the method. And so the big question now is whether we could get convergence of microscopic fluctuations, so to get rid of all these determinantal and Pfaffian and whatsoever approach. So this is kind of hopefully work in progress with Paul Bourgaz. So the idea would just be to try to develop a Stein method to prove convergence, for instance, to the Tracy-Widom law, which is a nice goal. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this nice talk. Are there any questions? Must be. Yes, Cedric.
He wants presents.
Why?
Not my presents. Two questions. First, the Stein method in the classical sense which you showed, can it lead to explicit error estimates of deviation with respect to the limit law? I mean, not doing it in with limit points, but with more precise computation?
Yeah. There are actually, I think that in the work of the people from Toulouse, no, recently they've been using kind of estimates in Stein methods, and actually as to estimate really the speed of convergence to the limiting law. Yes.
And then When you motivated the talk, you gave us several examples of distribution, something that is uniform, something that is random independent, so the zeta function, whatever. And there were two weird columns, jiggled something.
What so I must say, I don't know what this is, but I didn't know how to suppress it. I looked at the signification.
Even
in French, it was unclear to me.
Okay, so I switched to another question. In the last moment, you talked about approximate transport. Yeah. Is there some kind of Monge-Ampère type equation behind?
Yeah, of course. So, okay, so when you want to compute this, the idea would be to write Monge-Ampère equation to see what your transport map should satisfy. So when you write Monge-Ampère, what you realize is that you cannot solve this equation unless you are in a perturbative situation. I mean, in this case, the transport is near to identity, and so you have a very well posed equation, and you can use implicit function theorem. So when you want to go from two very different situations, the idea is that you should do some interpolation of the potential. So you do some interpolation of your potential V with a quadratic potential, and then what you get is that the transport map should satisfy the Poisson equation. And the Poisson equation is the one which is related to Schwinger-Dyson equation. So somehow everything is really about finding the right Poisson equation in your model. What is a bit surprising in this story is actually the equation that Nekrasov got, which is not... which is apparently going a bit beyond this kind of classical equations, Poisson equation and Monge-Ampère equation.
Any further questions?